Hello and welcome to today's dLife presentation, Diabetes and Eye Care. Today's webinar is sponsored by DiabetesSiteRisk.com, brought to you by Regeneron. Be sure to check out www.DiabetesSiteRisk.com to learn more about diabetic eye conditions, symptoms, treatments, preventative techniques, and more. Before we get started, we'd like to cover just a couple pieces of housekeeping. We do have browser requirements for this webinar, so please make sure you're using Safari 3.0, Firefox 4.0, Chrome 5.0, or Internet Explorer 7.0 or newer. To get the best audio quality, we do recommend calling in using a landline and not using your computer speakers. All participants today are muted. In order to ask a question or make a comment, please submit via the question feature on the right-hand side of your screen, and we will address your questions during the Q&A. Today's webinar is also being recorded. The recording will be sent to all registrants in a follow-up email. We'd like to remind everyone that credits are not offered for the dLife Edutainment Series. For upcoming webinars, diabetes tools, and online resources, or to become a dLife member, it's absolutely free. Visit www.dlife.com/member. Without further ado, we'd like to introduce today's host, Dr. Paul Chow. He's an optometrist out of Tacoma, Washington, and a dLife columnist. Dr. Stout has authored over 80 articles on diabetes and diabetic eye disease and frequently lectures on these topics in the U.S. and internationally. Dr. Stout, thank you so much for joining us today.
Oh, it's my great pleasure. Thanks so much. Good morning, everybody. It's also my great pleasure this morning to introduce Dr. Mandeep Brar, who is an endocrinologist and director of diabetes care for Abrazo Health Systems in Phoenix, Arizona. So welcome, Dr. Brar.
Thanks, Paul. I'm happy to be here.
It's also my great pleasure to introduce our other panelist, who is Dr. Charles Wyckoff. He's a retinal specialist at Retina Consultants of Houston, Texas. Our goal today is to bring you the unique perspectives of three different specialists who are involved in protecting and preserving the eye health of patients with diabetes. So today we're going to talk about several different topics. We want to talk about the importance of making and keeping regular appointments for dilated eye examinations in patients that have diabetes. We'll also discuss the different types of doctors you should see and when, as well as what patients and patients with diabetes should expect from our eye appointments, including diagnosis and treatment of some serious eye problems that are commonly seen in patients that have diabetes. So I'd like to talk about a few important statistics before we get going about diabetes and its effects on the eyes. So the first thing is that nearly 30 million Americans have diabetes, and I'm one of those 30 million. And if we live with the condition long enough, virtually every person with diabetes will develop an eye disease called diabetic retinopathy over time. In fact, diabetes remains a leading cause of blindness in the United States. And most of those cases are due to this condition called diabetic retinopathy. It's really vitally important for every person with diabetes to know that oftentimes diabetic retinopathy does not cause any symptoms whatsoever until it gets to a stage that threatens vision. Conversely, it's also important to realize that good vision on an eye chart or in the real world does not mean that a person with diabetes doesn't have severe eye disease that could lead to blindness if left undiagnosed and untreated. So now, these negative statistics to the side, let's put all of these in perspective. This is the really good news for those of us that have to live with diabetes. With good diabetes control, early diagnosis of diabetic retinopathy, and timely treatment of more severe diabetic retinopathy, about 90% of all blindness can be prevented. So that's critically important to know. So I'd like to move on now to our first kind of topic for discussion. Let's talk for a moment about diabetic retinopathy. So Dr. Wyckoff, what is diabetic retinopathy? And would you please give us your key insights regarding prevention of severe vision loss from diabetes?
Absolutely. Thanks, Paul. So diabetic retinopathy is essentially at its core a problem with diabetes affecting small blood vessels. So the root cause of diabetic problems in most organs involves damage to the smallest blood vessels within our body. And the retina, which we'll look at in a few slides, is unique in the entire body because it has the highest blood flow of any tissue in your body. And therefore, the inside of the eye and a part called the retina is particularly sensitive to the effects of diabetes. And those effects involve damaging the blood vessels, and therefore the blood vessels slowly leak. They leak blood, the red stuff that you get if we bruise our arms or our legs. But they also leak the lipid and the protein and the fluid inside of our blood that isn't necessarily just the red stuff that you think of when you're bleeding. It's that swelling, it's that fluid accumulation of protein and lipids and exudate that causes the majority of vision loss from diabetic retinopathy. But the other form of diabetic retinopathy is the growth of abnormal scar tissue that can lead to retinal detachments and extensive bleeding. So there's really two main manifestations of diabetic retinopathy: swelling or edema in the back, and then the growth of abnormal blood vessels called proliferative diabetic retinopathy.
Terrific. So do you have any insights for us regarding the prevention of severe vision loss from diabetes, Dr. Wyckoff?
Yeah, absolutely. And we'll spend the whole sort of hour talking about this, but really the treatment for diabetic retinopathy comes down to two major avenues. One is systemic cardiovascular risk factors and stop the damage to those small blood vessels. The earlier in the stage of diabetic retinopathy that you stop it, you slow it down, the better. Once there are manifestations inside the eye, there are a host of ocular-specific treatments, but the key is getting access to those treatments, to getting screened, and when you have early diabetic retinopathy, getting the treatment that you need.
Terrific. That's great. So now, Dr. Wyckoff, would you please take us through some of the important details in the next couple of slides regarding diabetic retinopathy?
Yeah, absolutely. So here are some pictures of a normal retina. Ocular anatomy is fascinating and beautiful in many ways, but the most basic way to think about the eye is really two compartments. There's the anterior part of the eye, which is shown on the left here, really made up of the cornea, the pupil, the colored part you see in people's eyes, and then the lens right behind it. And that anterior part of the eye, the entire objective there is to allow light to enter the eye and be focused on the back of the eye. Now, the back of the eye is where diabetic retinopathy manifests itself, and it manifests itself in the retina. So the retina is this orange-colored tissue that's about as thick as a you can go back one more slide for me if you don't mind just for a second. It's that orange color tissue back there that lines the inside sphere of the eye. It's about as thick as a human hair, so it's really thin, but it's really important. And then there's two major locations within the normal retina. There's the macula, which is shown there, and that's where your good central vision comes from, and that's only about as big as a quarter in surface area. And then there's the rest of the retina that provides your peripheral vision. Next slide, please. So once you have the effects of diabetes in the back of the eye or diabetic retinopathy, there are really three major manifestations that you see when you look in the eye, and this is what your eye doctor would see. On the top left here, you can see areas of actually bleeding into the retina, those red dots, and then you see the yellow dots also. So the yellow dots are the protein and the lipid that are leaking out of the normal blood vessels, and the blood vessels here are those sort of string-like structures that are blood vessels emanating from the optic nerve. And both of the top two photos are focused and centered on the macula. That's where your good central vision comes from. The photo in the middle at the bottom shows a different manifestation of diabetic retinopathy, which is active bleeding not into the retina, but into the vitreous, so into the cavity of clear fluid that fills the eye, and this is a different manifestation of diabetic retinopathy.
Terrific stuff. So our next topic concerns the importance of getting routine dilated eye examinations for people with diabetes. So here we see an example on the left of a patient with a pupil that is of normal size, and on the right, the same patient with a dilated pupil. So basically, the pupil has grown in size with the administration of eye drops. I like to tell my patients that a dilated pupil gives me a much larger window to look through when I'm examining the health of their eyes, and it also gives me a much greater chance of detecting potential problems. So Dr. Brar, I'm curious, what do you tell your patients with diabetes about the importance of getting regular dilated eye exams?
I give them a couple simple facts. First, that we know that diabetes can affect the blood vessels in the back of the eye. We know that often they don't have symptoms until it's much too late, as both you and Dr. Wyckoff had said earlier, and that the best way to take a look at the back of the eye and what effects the diabetes is having is by dilating the eye and having either an optometrist or an ophthalmologist take a look. And I also think that it's important for the repeat exam, the next exam the next year, to be done by the same provider or at least somebody who has access to images or notes so we can have a comparison.
Yeah, that's a really excellent point. The comparison is very helpful to the eye doctor. So, Dr. Wyckoff, you already talked about this, but there's this specific type of diabetic retinopathy that causes the majority of vision loss in people with diabetes, and that's diabetic macular edema. Can you explain this condition maybe a little more, some of its major risk factors and some of the common symptoms that patients may or may not experience? We're not getting sound from Dr. Wyckoff that I can hear.
Can you hear me?
Now we can. There we go. Thanks.
Oh, sorry. So thank you, Paul. So I absolutely agree with what Paul had to say, and that is that diabetic macular edema, or swelling of the retina, causes the vast majority of blindness and vision loss from diabetic retinopathy. And the major risk factors for that are duration of diabetes, how well controlled the diabetes is, how well controlled other cardiovascular risk factors are, and then other less common findings such as sleep apnea that your doctor can talk to you about if you have that. Once you have diabetic retinopathy involving the macula that causes diabetic macular edema, the treatment for that can involve lasers or medications that are injected into the eye that we'll talk about in a few slides.
Right. You know, so one of the things that I think is interesting and for patients to realize is that the recommendations for getting dilated eye examinations differ a little bit between people with type 1 versus people with type 2 diabetes. Dr. Barr, can you explain that?
So what we recommend, and this is based off the American Diabetes Association guidelines, is that an initial dilated comprehensive, so very thorough eye examination by your eye doc should be performed within 5 years of diagnosis for a person with type 1 diabetes. And for a person with type 2 diabetes, it should be pretty much done soon after diagnosis, and not a year after, but within a couple of months after diagnosis. And that's commonly because as a type 2 diabetic, you can have underlying symptoms and not be diagnosed for many years. And those many years of high sugars can affect the retina and cause damage that you're not noticing on your day-to-day life and in your vision.
Yeah, I think it's a really important point because the statistics say that when you're first diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, about 1 in 5 patients already has some degree of diabetic retinopathy. So you really don't want to delay getting your eye exam. Even if your blood sugars are out of control, it's important that you go in and get the eyes dilated and be evaluated for the presence of retinopathy upon diagnosis, specifically with type 2 diabetes.
That's true. And often patients will think, well, my eyes are blurry and it might be because of the sugars and that's what we've told them. But that is completely separate from the retina and the retinopathy, so delaying is not necessarily a good thing.
Right.
And then when it comes to subsequent exams, yearly for both groups, if there's retinopathy, and then for type 1 patients, maybe every 3 to 5 years after that initial exam, if there was no retinopathy and they were very young.
So let's talk about some of the takeaways for the discussion here about eye exams. So the first thing is that dilating the pupils absolutely is the best way to help your eye doctor detect diabetic retinopathy. And in fact, there's other eye conditions that are associated with diabetes, like cataracts and glaucoma. And diagnosing those conditions is really facilitated by getting a dilated eye examination as well. So we talked about the recommendations for patients with type 2 getting dilated at diagnosis. With type 1 diabetes, about 3 years after diagnosis, and the general recommendation, depending on the level of blood sugar control, is about every year thereafter, sometimes longer if patients have excellent control. In terms of diabetic macular edema, I think it's really important. The first thing is we've got a list of some symptoms here, but it's critically important that all of us with diabetes know that the most common form of severe vision loss from diabetes, which is diabetic macular edema, may not cause any symptoms. So it's really smart to get regular dilated eye exams, whether you have symptoms or not. However, these are some of the more common symptoms that we may see in patients with macular edema, things like blurred vision that isn't helped by glasses, distortion of straight lines, dark spots or floaters in your vision, and fading of colors, because the macula is responsible for seeing color vision and good detailed vision. So let's talk about what we might expect from a thorough diabetes eye exam, either by an optometrist or an ophthalmologist. So because many health conditions and medicines can affect the eyes, you know, your eye doctor is going to ask you about your medical history, specifically your diabetes management, followed by determining your best possible vision on the eye chart. The doctor should make sure the muscles of your two eyes coordinate well together, that your pupils react properly to light, and that your side vision is normal. And then after checking the internal pressure of the eye, which is one of the tests we do for glaucoma, a dilated eye exam should be performed. And that means that eye drops will be placed into your eyes to make the pupils larger, allowing more detailed examination of the internal eye. And this lets eye doctors not only see the back of your eyes better, but also in stereo, in 3D. Sometimes photographs or scans of the retina are taken, and this helps us to assess changes over time. It allows your various providers to share information with each other. And at the end of the eye exam, the doctor should explain his or her findings, what they mean, what your specific treatment plan entails, and tell you, the patient, exactly when and by whom you should get your next dilated eye exam. Finally, I think your eye doctor should send a report of your eye exam results to your primary care physician or endocrinologist. So Dr. Barr, as an endocrinologist, what happens after you receive the eye exam report?
Well, often we receive the eye exam report while the patient's not in clinic, so it comes in faxed into our computer system. I'll take a look at it. If I have any questions or concerns, I'll call the doc and pose my questions. And then when the patient comes into clinic, we actually go over the eye exam results and what the recommendations were from their eye doc.
Terrific. And a point that I've heard you make before, Dr. Barr, is not a bad idea to have the eye doctor jot down and hand to the patient kind of the essential findings of the eye exam so the patient can actually hand deliver that to the endocrinologist or family practice doc. Do you think that's a reasonably good idea?
I think that's a great way of engaging the patient in their care and the communication that we have on the back end about the patient's disease process.
So, Dr. Wyckoff, are there any other points that you'd like to communicate to the primary care doc or to the endocrinologist, especially for patients you see that are requiring treatment for serious diabetic retinopathy?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the more that we all take a team approach to this disease, I think the better care patients get. And actively being involved in your own care is critical to this. So every time you see a doctor, whether it's an eye doctor, an endocrinologist, or any kind of doctor, my recommendation as a patient is that you ask for a written note of what the doctor's follow-up.
Great. So we'll move on to the next topic, which is the importance of achieving and trying to maintain good diabetes control in order to prevent or at least minimize eye complications of diabetes. So, you know, we often hear patients are told to manage their ABCs. So, Dr. Parr, what does that mean and why is it so important?
So simply put, the ABCs stand for A being hemoglobin A1C, B being blood pressure, and C, cholesterol. And each of these, we have individualized goals for our patients based off their medical history. So in the past, we used to have a random singular number that we would try to have everybody fit into, and now it's much more specific for the individual that's sitting in front of you. And so controlling these three things, hemoglobin A1C being a function of what your blood sugars have been for the past 3 months, your blood pressure, and then your cholesterol, will actually decrease your risk of developing complications or decrease the progression of a complication that you may have.
So Dr. Wyckoff, do you think that control of the ABCs makes a real difference in terms of preventing vision loss from diabetic retinopathy and diabetic macular edema?
Absolutely. This is the cornerstone of treatment and prevention of diabetic retinopathy. There's good data dating back 20, 30 years that no matter what your stage of diabetic retinopathy, whether you have no disease or advanced disease, that if you are able to control your A1C, your blood pressure, and your cholesterol better, that you are more likely to continue to have better vision going forward.
So, you know, in summary, the takeaways from this topic, we think it's really critical that patients try to optimize their diabetes control in coordination with their diabetes physician, and as Dr. Brar said, to individualize the A1C goal in particular. So studies show that, you know, each 10% reduction in A1C, so for example, if your A1C is 8, if you can lower it 10% from an 8 to a 7.2%, that's a 10% reduction. That reduces the risk of diabetic retinopathy getting significantly worse by more than 40%. So the idea here is that you get a pretty significant effect for a relatively small reduction in your average blood sugar levels. It also seems to be important to get good diabetes control soon after diagnosis. And some people call this the legacy effect or protective metabolic memory. Dr. Brar, can you comment on this finding?
Sure. So as you said, the legacy effect, or also known as metabolic memory, it was seen at the 10-year follow-up of a trial that was called UKPDS, which actually stands for United Kingdom Prospective Diabetes Study. And so this trial included people with type 2 diabetes that were placed on a more intensive treatment during the trial only, and then but not followed actively afterwards. So they had no intensive intervention, let's put it that way, or intensive lowering of their blood glucose after the study. And then they looked at data of these people 10 years after the study had actually ended, and it was seen that there was a significant reduction in microvascular complications, and microvascular complications including diabetic retinopathy. So if you control your blood sugars at this moment very well, it will benefit you in the future, even if your blood sugars weren't controlled at that point in time in regards to development of complications.
That's a really important point. So let's talk about the different types of doctors for a moment. You know, there's often confusion about the doctors patients should see regarding their overall diabetes management as well as for their eye exams. And so in this section, we'll talk about the different types of doctors, what they do, what role they So Dr. Brar, can you explain the difference between a primary care physician and an endocrinologist, and when you think patients should go to each one of these providers regarding their diabetes care?
So I'll start off saying that everybody should have a primary care provider because they're your quarterback. They do everything from your diabetes and blood pressure care to if you broke a bone or needed some sort of screening test, or you have the flu. So they do everything for you, and they're pretty well versed in the care of diabetes. And so that is the person that you should always have as your quarterback. And then through discussions with your primary care provider and evaluating how you think your blood sugar control is, you can broach the subject of seeing a diabetes specialist, who's also known as an endocrinologist. And definitely if you feel that your sugars are not well controlled or you need a focused conversation during a visit that doesn't include any other problem, that would be a good time to see an endocrinologist specifically.
Right. It's a really important point, I think, for all providers, you know, that your endocrinologist, your primary care physician, you know, work together collaboratively in your best interest. That's their job, and that's what they want to do. So I want to say a few words about the different types of eye doctors, so just because there's a lot of confusion about this. So optometrists are eye doctors, and we're trained to diagnose and treat disorders and diseases of the eyes through non-surgical means, and that includes prescription medications. Ophthalmologists are medical doctors. They're trained to diagnose and treat eye disorders and diseases through both surgical and non-surgical means. So there are, in fact, many more optometrists and ophthalmologists in our country. So often these two specialists work together collaboratively, especially when patients require more invasive treatments like laser therapy or injection of medications into the eye, or eye surgery for that matter. So Dr. Brar, when you see a patient with diabetes, do you recommend the patient see an optometrist or an ophthalmologist?
My only recommendation really is that they need to get an eye exam. And then in this day and age, we look at what their insurance coverage is, and we try to get them into whomever is covered. I don't really try to push a patient towards an ophthalmologist unless they need specifically a retina specialist. So that's what I recommend to my patients.
Right, and I would agree with that. So let's assume for a moment the optometrist or the ophthalmologist has discovered severe retinopathy that threatens the patient's vision, and now that patient's being referred to a retinal specialist. So Dr. Wyckoff, can you explain what a retina specialist is and how such patients with severe retinopathy are typically managed? I know you touched on this earlier.
Yeah, a retina specialist is an MD ophthalmologist who has additional training in the treatment of diseases involving and affecting the retina. One of the most common is, of course, diabetic retinopathy. And so if you're receiving treatment for diabetic retinopathy, it makes sense in many cases that a retina specialist would be involved with that treatment. And then once that treatment is begun, there are really two types of ocular-specific treatments. There are medications that can be used and injected directly into the eye, and there are various kinds of lasers that can be used. And in most circumstances, a retina specialist is the person performing those treatments for diabetic retinopathy.
So our takeaways for the different types of doctors are essentially that, you know, your primary care physician, your endocrinologist, can work together collaboratively. And similarly, the three types of eye doctors, so optometrists, ophthalmologists, and retina specialists who are ophthalmologists with specialty training, we often work together with diabetes doctors to make sure that patients get the best possible care. Patients can typically be examined by any of the three eye specialists, but when patients who develop severe retinopathy that require treatment are diagnosed, really they should be seen by an ophthalmologist that has great experience with managing their particular condition. And retina specialists are the most qualified to see the most complex cases. So Dr. Wyckoff touched on the next topic a bit, so we'll explore it a little bit more, how diabetic retinopathy is treated. So Dr. Wyckoff, you've already talked about laser therapy and the like. Would you please explain to us what anti-VEGF medications are?
Yeah, absolutely. So again, the way that I talk about with my patient's treatment, I talk about two cornerstones up front. I focus heavily on the systemic control, the coordination with their primary care, their endocrinologist. That's critical. Once diabetic retinopathy crosses a threshold, and that threshold is different for different people, we then initiate ocular-specific treatments. So lasers, many different kinds of lasers can be used for this. But the real new advance over the last 10 years has been the development of medications that we inject directly into the eye. And there are two major classes of these. There are so-called anti-VEGF medications, which are biological agents that block a very specific growth factor. They're very targeted medications that really blunt the effect of diabetic retinopathy in certain circumstances. And then we also use other medications, most commonly a steroid, of which there are many options. These medications are almost always used in the setting of diabetic macular edema, which is, of course, as we talked about, when you have swelling of the back of your eye, and they work very well in this circumstance to improve the swelling and optimize visual outcomes on a long-term basis. And overall, we've seen that the earlier you initiate these treatments in patients with significant diabetic retinopathy, the better the long-term outcomes.
Yeah, it's a really important point, getting early treatment. And the other thing, you know, I like to mention to my patients is that we have a therapy now with these anti-VEGF agents that not only prevents their vision from deteriorating, from getting worse, but it actually can improve vision. And the other thing I like to tell my patients that the worst part about hearing, you know, the worst part about getting an injection into the eye is learning that you need an injection to the eye. The reality is that the shots themselves are really no worse than any other type of injection.
Yeah, Paul, it's a great point. You know, I always tell patients when I'm about to do an injection for the first time, look, this sounds barbaric. I'm going to put a needle inside of your eye. I mean, it sounds horrible. But the truth is that needles are literally tiny. You can barely see them without a microscope, and the vast majority of patients feel very little, if anything, and they look at me afterward and say, wow, that's it? So most patients tolerate the treatments very well, and it is, in many cases, very helpful for their visual function.
So let's talk for a moment about communicating with your doctors and how to get the best possible care. So, you know, how can patients best communicate with the various doctors? You know, I'm a big fan of patients writing down their questions before they come in for an appointment, and also of asking my patients to write down my most important clinical recommendations. I've kind of found that if I ask patients to write things down, it sticks in their memory a little bit better, and then I can follow up and ask them if they've stuck to the goals that we've set during the eye examination. So Dr. Barr, I'm wondering, how do you help engage your patients to participate as a partner in their diabetes care?
We actually do something very similar here in clinic, and we use computerized medical records, and so we have a portion that allows us to put patient goals or patient recommendations. And so the patient and I will actually type them up together. I do the typing, they tell me the wording, repeating back to me what I had recommended that they do. And that way it sticks a little bit better. And then it's printed out and given to them, and they put it on their fridge or wherever they keep their important docs, and they can look at it and remind them.
Yeah, I think having written goals down is really important. We're all humans, including, you know, those of us that are doctors, and when you see something over and over again, it just helps to kind of solidify it in your mind. Dr. Wyckoff, do you have any additional thoughts about this?
Yeah, my other thought would be when you're going to see a doctor of any kind, but especially eye doctors and endocrinologists related to your diabetic care, take someone with you. Take a family member, take a friend, take someone that's engaged in your everyday life. It helps to have another brain, another set of ears listening to the recommendations of the doctor so that they can then help you remain accountable and follow through on their treatment recommendations.
I think that's such an important point. So I'm going back. I've had diabetes now 47 years, and so 30 years ago, I was told during an eye exam that I had severe diabetic retinopathy and that I needed immediate treatment to avoid blindness. Well, guess how much I heard after I was told that by my doc? Not much. And I was alone, and I think one of the more important things is to have somebody with you, as Dr. Wyckoff said, for your diabetes appointment. So let's talk, let me summarize the communication points. We think it's a good idea to write down your questions prior to your exam, bring a pen and paper with the appointment, ask your doctor, as we said earlier, to write down his or her recommendations, and specifically ask your doctors to communicate and work with each other in your best interest. So most doctors try to do this, want to do this, but it doesn't always happen. And as patients, we can really help doctors to communicate better with each other by specifically asking them to do so. And always remember, the docs are there to help you to make sure you understand your diagnosis and your treatment plan. So if there's something you don't understand, ask, because it's your doctor's job to explain things to you in a way that is understandable. So here are some questions to ask your eye doctor that we think may be a reasonably good idea. So what is my diagnosis? Can you explain this in a way that is understandable? Is this something that can be treated? What specifically is the treatment plan for me, and when does it need to begin? And if you don't need treatment, you want to ask your eye doc, how often should I return for a checkup? And what is the likely direction that my particular diagnosis will take? Are there any symptoms I should look for, and what do I do if I notice symptoms like blurred vision or fuzzy spots in my vision? And is there anything else I can do to help protect my vision? So those are reasonably good specific questions to ask your eye doctor. So now we'll move on to some closing thoughts. I've really enjoyed talking with our expert panel today. I'm so grateful to Drs. Brar and Wyckoff. Dr. Brar, do you have any final thoughts for our audience?
I think the important takeaway point from an endocrinologist standpoint is know your ABC goals, what they are for you in particular, and then what is the plan to get those goals to where they need to be, and remember to get your dilated retinal exam through an eye doc.
And Dr. Wyckoff, do you have any final thoughts for our audience?
Yeah, from a retina specialist, diabetic retinopathy causes a lot of visual problems in our society. In most cases, these are treatable and possibly preventable if we get the patient early. So if you have diabetes, you got to get screened for retinal disease. Anyone that can dilate your eye and look at your retinas, ophthalmologist, optometrist, get screened. And then if you have significant diabetic retinopathy, see a specialist that would be able to treat you.
Terrific stuff. So, you know, in closing, I'd like to emphasize to everyone listening to this program today that the chances of losing your vision to diabetes, and that's one of the patient's biggest fears, that risk can be drastically reduced by achieving and maintaining good diabetes control and by getting regular dilated eye examinations from an optometrist or an ophthalmologist. So Drs. Brar and Wyckoff, I want to thank you for joining us today, and we want you to know in the audience that we are all on your side.
Thanks, Paul.
Thanks, guys.
So now I guess we'll turn it over to any questions that audience members may have. We're happy to entertain them. You can type them in. So the first question is, how do I know if my eyesight is failing due to diabetes and not just from getting older? So I'll field that question quickly, and I'm happy to hear anybody else's responses. But the first thing to understand about diabetes, the main reason people with diabetes don't see well is the same reason that all individuals don't see well. That is that they need eyeglasses or contact lenses to see properly. And so the way you find this out is by getting an eye examination to determine if your vision can be improved with spectacle lenses, and then to have your eyes dilated to check for any other eye diseases. So there are literally thousands of different eye conditions that can cause failing eyesight and loss of vision, and diabetes is just one of those. So the only way to really find out for sure is by seeing an eye doctor.
I'll take the next question. Who qualifies for anti-VEGF treatments? That's a great question, because classically, anti-VEGF treatments are used exclusively for the management of diabetic macular edema, again, the most common cause of vision loss and blindness in diabetic retinopathy. But there are other kinds of diabetic retinopathy also. What is becoming more clear as we do more trials of the value of anti-VEGF medications is that their use is expanding. So we are now beginning to use them for a broader collection of diseases related to diabetes. And so this is why it's critical to be seen by doctors that are really, in my opinion, any diabetic retinopathy.
So this kind of leads to the next question, which is an interesting one. How does the wet form of macular degeneration, this is a condition associated with older age, leads to bleeding under the retina. So how does that differ from diabetic retinopathy? So Dr. Wyckoff?
Again, a great question. So AMD, or age-related macular degeneration, the wet form of that disease is characterized by the abnormal growth of blood vessels under and into a person's retina, which causes scarring and bleeding, and you treat that with injections of anti-VEGF medications. Diabetic retinopathy has a different pathophysiology. The core problem is actually death of normal blood vessels, and the remaining blood vessels become too leaky. Additionally, you can get the growth of abnormal blood vessels, like in AMD, but they come from a different location inside of the eye. So while they are treated with similar medications, the core problem is very different.
So here's another common question we hear: do floaters diminish with time? So that's an interesting question. So Dr. Wyckoff's a vitreoretinal specialist. The vitreous is where floaters occur, the gelatin that lines the inside cavity of the eye. But essentially, floaters are trapped inside our eyes. The only way to totally get rid of them is essentially to have them surgically removed. But what happens over time is typically we learn to tune them out. And gravity does kind of make them settle to the bottom of the eye. It's kind of like one of those little snow globes that you shake up. So if you do cartwheels, you're going to see them again if you pay attention. But typically, people's awareness of floaters does diminish over time. Any extra thoughts on that, Dr. Wyckoff?
Yeah, I completely agree. It sort of depends on what the cause of the floaters is. That is causing the floaters, and if that's the case, it's not going to get better or diminish over time unless it's treated. It will, in fact, likely get worse. But the typical kind of floaters that's not related to diabetes typically become less noticeable with time. But if you are noticing new floaters, I would tell this to really anybody, I think it's worthwhile getting an exam.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. So how does sleep apnea cause vision problems? That's a really important question. You know, there's emerging evidence now that sleep apnea, independent of your blood sugar and your blood pressure control, is an independent risk factor for developing diabetic retinopathy and specifically diabetic macular edema. So, you know, the thought is that when you have sleep apnea, you're not getting enough oxygen into your bloodstream. And when the retina does not get enough oxygen, and it gets oxygen like the rest of the body from blood supply, the retina kind of goes into a crisis mode, and typically blood vessels are damaged by a shortage of oxygen. Sleep apnea is a major problem in a lot of people with diabetes, and there's multiple risk factors for it, including having a large neck circumference. So I tell my patients, if you snore or your spouse or loved one tells you you stop breathing in the middle of the night, you should get a sleep study. And I think really any patient with diabetes who has a neck circumference that is above 17 inches, so if your shirt collar is more than 17 inches, you should talk to your physician about getting a sleep study. I think it's really important because apnea, not only a risk factor for eye disease, it's a risk factor for stroke and other cardiovascular problems. So now here's an excellent question. What about the new equipment that checks your eyes without dilating, but instead used a type of air puff machine? So these are actually two separate questions referring to two different types of devices. So the first is a device that's designed to photograph the inside of the eye, essentially, through an undilated pupil. And then the second is a question about a device that's used to check for glaucoma. So, you know, I have my take on this. Dr. Wyckoff is a retina specialist. I'd like to hear your take on this device that can image the inside of the eye through an undilated pupil. I don't think it's adequate. I would not rely on that for a loved one that had diabetes, and that's the standard I use for my patients. I want a big pupil so I can be absolutely sure I see everything, and I see it in 3D, which you need a large pupil to do.
Yeah, I agree. I think under ideal conditions, everyone would receive a very comprehensive exam, including a dilated fundus exam. The newer imaging equipment that allows wide field photographic documentation of your retinas are valuable because they allow you to document what an eye looks like at a certain time point and then follow that objectively over time. So the wide field imaging is fantastic and very, very useful, but does not replace the need for a dilated exam.
And there is, so this is new evidence. It just came out of the Joslin Diabetes Center in Boston, Massachusetts. But they've actually published a paper recently that showed that if you have a lot of retinopathy damage in the periphery of the retina, so not in the macular area, but farther outside of the macula, that those patients actually have a greater propensity for developing more severe diabetic retinopathy. So it's a great argument to look at the peripheral retina, and this sort of device lets you do that. So the next person asks, can you talk a little bit about diabetic cataracts? So, you know, a cataract is a clouding of the lens that's inside the eye, and when we're born, it's a clear structure, and with time, all of us get clouding of the lenses in our eye, and when that impairs our vision, we call that a cataract. So the first thing is that every human being, if we're lucky to live long enough, will get cataracts. It's inevitable if you live long enough. But in diabetes, because of high blood glucose levels, cataract formation is accelerated, essentially. Glucose, sugar, in your bloodstream gets into the eye, and it actually bonds to the collagen fibers inside the lens, and that results in a loss of transparency of the lens. So here's a great question. After how many years of having type 1 diabetes, do you generally see changes in your vision? Dr. Barr, do you have any thoughts about that?
That's a great question. Typically, we say anywhere from 5 to 10 years after having type 1 diabetes that's not well controlled, will you have changes in your vision? There's some nuances to that. If we attempt to have very tight control while a type 1 patient is pregnant, we may then increase the risk for retinopathy as well if we do that too quickly. So there's some nuances there as well.
Yeah, and you know, the old statistic is that by 10 years, about 60% of people with type 1 diabetes have some degree of diabetic retinopathy. And typically, it doesn't have effect on their vision at that stage. But, you know, with improved blood glucose control, we know that's so important now. We think that those numbers are going to drop. So here's an interesting question from my standpoint, because I actually just completed a clinical trial regarding this question. What eye vitamins do you recommend, if any? So I'll just generally say the most important thing is that no pill is a substitute for a healthy diet. You need to eat a healthy diet, and that means eating especially lots of plant foods, okay? So eating more vegetables, more fruits, but especially more varieties of fruits and vegetables. We know that when a fruit or vegetable has bright colors to it, it contains a lot of phytonutrients, plant-based nutrients, that that are beneficial to eye health. And we know the risk of virtually every eye disease is diminished in people that eat a more plant-based diet. Specifically, from my standpoint, I ask my patients to get evaluated for vitamin D deficiency because low levels of D are associated with both diabetes and diabetic retinopathy. And patients that are on metformin, I believe, should be screened periodically for vitamin B12 deficiency and be supplemented because that's also been shown to be an independent risk factor for diabetic retinopathy. Dr. Wyckoff or Dr. Broad, do you have thoughts about this question, which is really, we could talk 3 hours about this question. It's a great question.
Yeah, the question related to eye vitamins is important because you walk into any pharmacy and you see rows and rows of eye vitamins for ocular health. The vast majority of those vitamins are proven to be of benefit in certain patients with macular degeneration. In diabetic retinopathy, there is no great data that shows that supplementing your diet with vitamins can slow the progression or treat diabetic retinopathy. But in macular degeneration, there is very good data for the use of vitamins. So it's important to ask your doctor to make sure that you should or should not be taking vitamins. But it's typically not diabetic related what those vitamins are for.
Dr. Barr, do you have any thoughts about this? An important topic. What do you tell your patients with diabetes when they ask you about taking, you know, supplements?
I just have them take a multivitamin once a day, encourage a healthier diet, and then from an endocrinologist standpoint, we really do talk quite a bit about vitamin D deficiency and what role that may play in regards to their blood glucose control, and that data is still kind of playing itself out, so we'll check a vitamin D level as well.
Right. And I'll just say, because I just, you know, so I have a vested interest because I've just submitted a paper to the British Journal of Ophthalmology about this, but we did a study in my office looking at the amount of these two pigments in the eye called lutein and zeaxanthin, and we know now that the macular degeneration supplements that Dr. Wyckoff alluded to are now contain these two plant-based pigments. And so in our work, we've shown that people with diabetes have much less lutein and zeaxanthin in our eyes. And you get lutein and zeaxanthin from the diet only. It's not something your body makes. And you can get it by eating particularly kale, which is high in both lutein and zeaxanthin. Spinach and collard greens also have a fair amount. But a lot of people, most Americans, in fact, just don't get enough lutein and zeaxanthin in our diet. And I, you know, the research evidence is emerging, but I think in the future we're going to see more evidence suggesting that that may be beneficial in terms of preventing diabetic retinopathy long term. But the jury's out. So how can fluid build up in the retina? How can that be managed? And so this is right up Dr. Wyckoff's alley.
Yeah, absolutely. So it all depends on what kind of fluid it is, where the fluid is. The most common kind of fluid is diabetic macular edema involving your central retina, your macula. And the core treatment for that currently, when you have vision loss from it, is injections of medication directly into your eye, most typically the anti-VEGF medications for that. The other side point to bring up about this is typically these injections are not a cure. Right? I tell patients kind of like taking their blood pressure medication. If they have high blood pressure and they take medication for a few days, well, blood pressure might measure normal, but that doesn't mean they stop taking their blood pressure medications. The current medications that we use work in much the same way for diabetic macular edema. They can work very well, but in many eyes, they wear off. And so most of the time, patients require repeated injections into the eye over time. And what the interval is between those injections is very patient specific. Usually it's beginning at about 1 month interval between injections. And then depending on a patient's response, that interval can increase significantly.
And Dr. Wyckoff, this is something that I'm asked, especially by my more well-read patients who look at the medical literature. What do you tell patients about the risk with these anti-VEGF medications regarding the possibility of forming blood clots, thromboembolism, and having a stroke or something of that nature?
Yeah, this is an important question, especially for diabetic patients who we know have a higher risk of systemic cardiovascular disease issues such as heart attack, stroke, blood clots. The totality of data suggests that injection of these medications into the eye does not substantially increase one's baseline risk of developing these problems.
Yeah, so that's the take-home message. It does not, all the studies and lots of studies have been done and are ongoing show that there's really no extra risk taken on by getting these kinds of treatments. So here's another question. I was told that diabetes cannot cause glaucoma. Is this true? Well, so my short answer is no, that's not true. But there's different types of glaucoma and there's a lot of controversy about it. So what I want to tell you up front is if you have diabetes, you're more likely to be diagnosed with everything. And the reason is because you're going to the doctor more often than the average patient. So if you go to the eye doctor every year to get assessed for diabetic retinopathy, I think as a function of being examined constantly, you're more likely to be diagnosed with any eye condition, and that might include glaucoma. But more precisely, diabetes, especially proliferative diabetic retinopathy, where these new abnormal blood vessels grow on the surface of the retina, that can also lead to a very specific form of glaucoma called neovascular glaucoma. And we know that diabetes is probably the major risk factor for developing that specific type of glaucoma. Dr. Wyckoff, I'd like your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I agree. So diabetes can certainly cause glaucoma. It's a more advanced form of diabetes or diabetic retinopathy. In fact, a very advanced sort of blindness-threatening form, which needs, in many cases, very acute, like same-day treatment. So it definitely can cause glaucoma. It's one of the reasons to be screened for diabetic retinopathy.
So the next question reads, my eye doctor could not find anything during the dilated eye exam, but I still could see the floaters. So that's something that is common, that the floaters are difficult to visualize often for the person examining your eye. Dr. Wyckoff is expertly skilled in doing this, and I bet he's better than the vast majority of eye doctors are at seeing them. But in general, quite often, floaters can't be visualized by the doctor as well as they can be visualized by the patient. Although there are some now techniques for visualizing floaters that allow us as the examiners to see what the patient sees.
It's worth just saying just for a moment what the most common cause of floaters is. Like, what are those things that you're seeing floating around if it's not due to blood or some other significant pathology? And in most cases, it's due to the vitreous gel collapsing over time. So what does that mean? Well, the inside of your eye is built around a scaffold of collagen called vitreous. And when we're born, that vitreous is an intact, very structured, organized place. And over time, naturally, that scaffold, that collagen matrix, collapses on itself and clumps in the middle of your eye. And so it's typically that. It's the collagen matrix that fills up the middle of your eye that you're seeing float around. And over time, usually they become less noticeable.
So here's another really excellent question. Will you develop vision problems even if you're taking care of yourself? And so let me address this momentarily, and then I'd like both of your opinions on this as well. So the data says that even if you maintain a good hemoglobin A1C, let's say 6.5%, which is kind of the standard often, espoused by the Academy of Clinical Endocrinology, and if your blood pressure is 120 over 80, if you're diagnosed with diabetic retinopathy today, your 10-year risk for developing severe diabetic retinopathy is still about 4%. It's not a high percent, but it is still possible to get serious eye disease even with good blood glucose control. Now, the risk of having that happen is much less if you have good metabolic control, but all of us with diabetes, no matter how low the hemoglobin A1C is, still have higher risk than the rest of the population. Any thoughts about that, Dr. Breyer, Dr. Wyckoff?
I would agree with you, Paul. You know, we try to tell patients that overall, if we hit the ABCs that we discussed earlier, you're at a good chance not having complications in your lifetime or complications that are significant in changing your quality of life. But there are always those patients that surprise us, and I think that's where our understanding of individual genetics and things like that in regards to a common disease. So we have limitations in understanding that for individual patients.
Right.
Yeah, I think this is a really frustrating topic for doctors and patients because, unfortunately, it's a cumulative disease. So even if you have diabetes that's well controlled, unfortunately, it's still diabetes, and it still can cause small problems and breakdown of normal blood vessels that accumulate over time, and so you can still get manifestations of the disease even if it's well controlled.
So the next question is sensitivity to sunlight or car headlights, is that a symptom of diabetic retinopathy? I would say typically that is not. That's more likely to be a symptom of cataract formation or of even dry eye disease. But, you know, again, the only way to know for sure is by having an eye exam. So I'm getting a note here that we're down to kind of what our last question should be. So the question is, please address double vision and its relationship to type 1 diabetes. So, you know, diabetes affects small blood vessels throughout the body, as Dr. Wyckoff, talked about earlier today. And so there are lots of small blood vessels also that supply the nerves that control the muscles of our eyes. And those are the muscles that allow our eyes to coordinate together. If your eyes don't point in the same direction, you get double vision. So what can happen in diabetes is that you get blockages of the little blood vessels that serve the nerves that control the eye muscles. And when the eye muscles don't work together, patients get double vision. So this is something that we see not all that uncommonly in patients with both type 1 and type 2 diabetes. It's called an extraocular muscle palsy or a nerve paresis is what it's commonly referred to. And typically this is something that does go away over time, typically 3 to 6 months. But again, patients with diabetes, it's important to know, because I'm an advocate, because I have diabetes, I'm an advocate for my patients to realize that sometimes doctors will blame everything, every medical symptom you have, on your diabetes. And sometimes patients with diabetes can have other problems that cause symptoms. So if a patient has double vision, especially if it's not going away, and especially if multiple muscles of the eye are involved, that's a patient that needs to have imaging of the brain done to make sure there's not something more serious going on, like a growth in the brain or a stroke.
Thank you so much, Paul. We're right about at our time, but I'd like to thank you and Dr. Barr and Dr. Wyckoff. Thank you guys so much for this important and really invaluable information. I know everybody learned a lot. I'd also like to thank, again, our sponsor for today, DiabetesSiteRisk.com, brought to you by Regeneron. Be sure to check out www.DiabetesSiteRisk.com to learn more about diabetic eye conditions, symptoms, treatments, preventative techniques, and more. For more information on eye care from dLife, visit dLife.com/vision. And to become a dLife member, visit dLife.com/member. Thank you again, and we hope everyone has a great day.